I got here with some haste today, I must say. Luckily, Pluto is still floating around our orbit, and I was able to speed travel here almost. Oddly enough, considering what I was telling you about in the last episode. Well, I wanted to get here quickly because I do not like leaving any of my characters in such predicament. As you remember, I left Blossom with a bunch of trolls somewhere on the flatlands. Goodness! And unfortunately, I have to listen to the calling birds. When they call me, I have to go. So, anyway, let us delve in. No, you shall want to find out what's going on. Two sturdy trolls had crept up behind Blossom and grabbed an arm each. She hung between their fingers, her tiny body swaying as they walked off with her into the thick woodland. "Put me down," she demanded, as both trolls dropped her to the ground in front of their leader and ruler, Doran. Blossom brushed herself down. "Goodness, how do you cope with all this dust? It's filthy on these plains," she said, suddenly feeling very small next to the huge trolls.
"Silence!"
boomed the voice of Doran, his giant jaw showing off his sharp teeth.
"What deceit has brought you to our realm, fairy child?" spat Doran. "Goodness me!"
As he crouched down to take a good look at Blossom in her nightgown. "Levitation," said Blossom, who was not at all impressed with all the shouting. The trolls turned to one another, whispering, sniggering and elbowing each other.
"Silence!"
boomed Doran once more, and all the murmurs stopped.
"Why do you come to the flatlands of Doran with your magic?"
He spat at Blossom, who was beginning to feel a little uncomfortable. "Well, yes. I need somewhere to practice speed, and here seemed the best place. I really didn't mean to bother anybody," said Blossom politely, and tried to turn around to leave.
"Practice? What is practice? This practice is trickery. You need our land for speed. You come with magic to take it from us. We cannot allow this to happen. The fairy realm cannot claim this land as theirs," growled Doran as he turned to his troll tribe and addressed them.
Huge cheers bellowed from the growing crowds, and Blossom was now wishing she was home. "Look, I meant no harm. I was just practicing. It can be a very tricky subject," explained Blossom. But the trolls did not understand what she was trying to say, and it just seemed to make things worse.
"Trickery! Trickery!"
boomed some of the other trolls, whilst the others started gathering logs and building fires. Goodness me, I know. The only thing Blossom could think to do was levitate back to the palace as quickly as she could. And so, that's exactly what she did. It was such a relief when she finally made it back to the safety of her chamber. Oh, and she breathed a sigh of relief. Blossom had never experienced hostility before, especially from such a big and, in her opinion, ugly creature who did not smell very nice at all. Dear. She would have to rethink her choice of realm in the morning, and the exhausted little fairy fell fast asleep. It was three strikes past the witching hour when the palace knaves rang out the warning bells. Blossom woke up with a start and could hear the footsteps of courtiers running from their chambers. Looking out of her window, she could make out the glow from fire torches approaching the palace gates and the faint chant of loud voices. It was the trolls. They had followed Blossom back to the fairy realm and were wanting answers from its queen on why their land was of importance for the practice of magic and what was the purpose of the thing they called speed. Goodness, exclaimed Blossom, yes, quite right, and jumped out of bed and put on her robe. She ran as fast as she could to her cousin, Lilybell's chamber. Lilybell had also heard the warning bells and was looking out of her window at all the commotion. Blossom, have you seen the lights from the window? Said Lilybell as Blossom burst into her room. I have, and I fear I am to blame, Lily. And I don't know what to do, as the Queen will be so angry, and Mrs. Skinnythorne said that I wasn't allowed to practice, and I did anyway, and I didn't listen, said an out-of-breath Blossom, clutching her nightgown. Slow down, dear cousin. What are you talking about? Blossom sat Lilybell down on the bed and told her as much as she could about her travels and adventures. Blossom and Lilybell Red had always got on so very well. So well that Lilybell treated Blossom as if she were her little sister. I'm sure Mother will understand you meant no harm, but you should have been more careful, Blossom. I just wanted to see outside the palace walls, and you wouldn't believe how beautiful it is, Lilybell, sighed Blossom, knowing she was in a lot of trouble. Lilybell took her by the hand and said it would be a lot better for her if she could tell her side of things before some angry troll did. And they headed up the long hallway towards the Queen's chamber. Outside the Queen's door, three burly knaves stood.
Halt! Who goes there?
One said.
It's Princess Lilybell, you fool, said the other.
So it is, said the third.
I'm afraid Her Majesty isn't here at the moment. She's taking counsel with Lord Flute as a matter of some urgency, he continued.
Still holding Blossom's hand, Lilybell knew there was no time to lose and they ran to the great hall as fast as they could, where all councils took place. Pushing the huge door open onto the marble floors, where many decisions had taken place in times gone by, Rosebud was sat on the large throne at the back of the hall, and to her left and right, councillors stood with feather pens and manuscripts. Lord Flute was by her side, and they were in deep conversation as the two little fairies burst in.
Ah, oh dear, exclaimed Lord Flute as he looked at the Queen, who got up with surprise and walked over to the pair, her long red gown flowing behind her.
Princess Lilybell, what are you doing here?
We are in council,
said Rosebud to her out-of-breath daughter, with Blossom standing beside her, who was not sure whether to curtsy or not.
Mother, Blossom has something she needs to say, said Lilybell as she pulled Blossom in front of her.
The Queen looked cross.
This really is not a good time for games, Lady Blossomberry. We have a rather pressing matter to sort out. If you haven't already noticed, we've had an unexpected visit from the Flatlands, explained the Queen.
Blossom nodded, curtsied and hid behind Lilybell again, who was not at all impressed with her cousin's sudden shyness at such an important time.
We know, Mother, and that is why we need to speak to you urgently, said Lilybell, half wishing she'd not got involved.
But it was too late. At that moment, the doors of the great hall opened and in marched Doran with one of his guards. He bowed to the Queen and sneered at the councillors.
Doran! What a surprise to have a visit from you so late after dusk, said the Queen calmly. And why do you wear your fighting armour as if going to war? She continued.
Doran stood silent for a moment, his silver armour glistening and his sword held firmly in one hand.
I come to claim back our land as our own, he bellowed. We do not want your magic
or practising in our homeland?
Spat Doran, looking around the room, not noticing Blossom, who was still hiding behind Lilybell. Lord Flute and the Queen whispered something to one another, and the Queen approached Doran and his guards, who stood with grimaced faces. There had not been an encounter with the Flatland Trolls for millions of moons, and why they should suddenly appear now was very puzzling to the Queen. Doran, our people are at peace. We would not use your land for our simple magic without your consent, said the Queen, but Doran was not impressed.
So now you lie to me as well.
He spat and raised his sword at the Queen as if to strike. All the knaves in the room drew their weapons and moved towards the pair of angry trolls.
If you do not tell me what you want with our land, I will strike you,
boomed Doran with fire in his eyes. Blossom, who had been hiding, could take no more. Do not strike Her Majesty. It is me you want, not the Queen.
Goodness! A huge gasp echoed around the great hall and Doran lowered his hand. Rosebud stepped back to the safety of her knaves, calmly nodding her head for them to retract their weapons, and returned to the safety of her throne, where a very pale Lord Flute had been writing down every word.
Explain, Lady Blossomberry,
demanded the Queen. And Blossom had no choice other than to address the council while two trolls looked on waiting for answers. She explained about how excited she had found levitation lessons and about the chapter she had found on parallel travel. She told them about the physics of levitation and speed and how she could not practice such difficult subject in the confinements of her chambers. And then finally she said about finding the Flatlands in a book and thinking that they were the perfect place to practice, and had gone there without anyone knowing. After she had stopped talking, there was a long silence. All the knaves stared at her in disbelief. Lord Flute could not believe his ears. Doran let out a big snort from his nostrils, and the Queen's face turned very stern. Lilybell joined Blossom and whispered in her ear, "I'm sure Mother will understand. Nothing bad will happen, I promise." And Blossom's worried frown lifted for a moment. The Queen called for two knaves to come to her side. And standing up to address the Great Hall, she began her judgment.
Lady Blossomberry of the Second Fairy Rising, you are guilty of breaking a sacred fairy law and disobeying your royal obligations. For this reason alone, you are in serious trouble. But for the practicing of sacred magic in lands without consent, and for the deceit of it, I banish you from this realm forever.
And with that, the Queen sat down and two knaves escorted Blossom out of the Great Hall and away from the palace to the edge of the fairy realm, where she would have to make her own way. Lilybell pleaded with her mother to reconsider, but with Doran needing to be appeased, the Queen was adamant that her ruling for Blossom to be banished was final. Oh dear. For the days that followed, nobody spoke of Lady Blossomberry or where she may be. The trolls returned to the Flatlands, but had many councils with the Fairy Queen thereafter to make sure that nothing like this ever happened again. Peace was resumed in the Fair Valley, and only Lilybell thought of her little cousin's fate with guilt. You see, a fairy's promise is as certain as daybreak and nightfall, and never broken. And knowing that the last words to Blossom were, "I promise," Lilybell could only pray that one day Blossom would be allowed to come home, and she was never quite the same again. She spent her days shouting at the servants and demanding things to make her feel better, especially cake. And so it was documented in the ancient manuscript. Some say the reason for her swift part was to find a fairy's soul,
as the tale of one who lost her clan was very often told. Told in warning, told at night, told around campfires, told to fright. But any fairy, be so bold, will find themselves out in the cold. Dear, 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 it makes me worry for poor Thimble. I do hope that she's getting on okay with her cake. Oh, it's the calling birds. I shall have to go. Next time we shall find out about how Thimble is getting on. Until then, take care and remember, don't stop believing, especially in you.